men to my left here. And I also want to say I'm particularly thankful about the fact that we were able to address the call to men. And as I look around, you know, it's painfully obvious that, you know, there are not even a lot of men in the audience. But I'm going to say this, and I'm going to say this in sincerity. I think that the sisters, the ladies, the women here have done a remarkable job. And we want you to continue, but we also want you to know that you will have partners going forward. This is a commitment. See, one of the things we talk about is the pain of change is forgotten, but the benefits of change are realized. One of the changes that we have to make is the dialogue. The dialogue, in particular, between men is interesting because men don't talk to each other the way women talk to each other. So there's a completely different range there. So as we address these talking points, I want to go to our panel, just to give you an idea who's here. We have Rabbi Bob Kaplan of the Jewish Relations Council. We have Rabbi Joseph Potasnik, New York Board of Rabbis. Brother Quentin Walcott, I don't know whether you're familiar with him or not, but he's Connect New York. And Reverend Joseph Brown Sr., who is also one of my partners on None on My Watch, Far Rockaway Vice Chair. Let's give them a hand. Let me just bring my questions up here. You know, when you get to be a certain age, you can't see stuff. Okay. The first question I want to direct to Rabbi Bob Kaplan, a very good friend of mine. Rabbi Kaplan, in regards to human trafficking, how do we go about getting more men involved, particularly in leadership roles, working in organizations such as Not On My Watch?
Great question, because if you look at the faith world, if you look at the not-for-profit world, if you look at power, how it's distributed, men obviously have a lot of power. We are often in the role of being the exec or the upper echelon of management within the not-for-profit world, and certainly in the faith world as well. However, let me talk about a phenomenon we have with, at JCRC, we run a number of fellowships, leadership fellowships. We have one for upcoming not-for-profit faith-based students, we have one for teens, called Youth Bridge, and generally, at least 70% of the folks that apply for these leadership fellowships, where you have to get down and get your hands dirty, so to speak, are women. And that means that women are stepping up a lot more often into difficult positions than men. So we've tried desperately, and this year I have to admit, Youth Bridge was about 52%. It was absolutely mixed about, you know, you know that women make about 52% of the total population, and men make about, you know, 48%. So how did we go about doing that? Is we had to be sensitive to the fact that men are not raised to look at these issues and to confront these issues. We're afraid of that side of us. We're told to be tough. Well, if you're going to really be tough, you got to be tough. That means you got to walk into tough situations and be willing to take on and stand up when things are incorrect in society, no matter what the issue. And certainly, this is an issue. So it's important to educate from a young age the ability to stand up and take on your masculinity in a way that is balanced. That you cannot be afraid of doing things that are going to, quote unquote, offend your masculinity. I know that sounds sort of incorrect when I say it, but we have to deal with reality of the world. So it's a process of allowing the messaging to be inclusive as well. And if we can continue to do that, we will get more of the men that have taken on what they think is the tough roles to step into what is really the tough role.
Thank you, Rabbi. The second question now I would like to direct to my other good friend, Rabbi Joseph Potasnik. And that is, Rabbi, how can we, as men, do more to contribute to the resolution of these human trafficking issues, and specifically your thoughts about what steps we would go about taking?
Thank you so much for inviting me. Is this on? Thanks for inviting me, and I've learned in my life you stand up for your principles, but you retreat when you see Q English coming. So I am a Q English, who says you've got to be there. No, don't be there. Let me say something to you. I want to begin as a male with an apology. We as men have done too little about a problem that is too widespread. Let me give you an example. When the President of the United States makes an offensive, outrageous comment, right, about treatment of women, there should have been a massive male demonstration. One of the things that we try to do is we try to be there for the other. For example, if a synagogue is desecrated, we have non-Jews standing with us. If a mosque or church are desecrated, we as Jews stand with them. We need to stand in for the other. Right? It's very easy for some people to stand and say something, but that, as Bob Kaplan just said before, that's not the challenge. It's when it's difficult that you stand up. Look, I can talk about anti-Semitism, racism. I can talk about it in the generic, but the real responsibility you have, especially when you're in the clergy, is you got to go against the racists, the anti-Semites, go against the specific individuals. So that's what I'm saying. When the president says that, you cannot sit back. I remember being on a bus one day in New York, and on this trip there was a guy there who had his eyes closed during the entire trip. We happened to get off together. And I said to him, I noticed your eyes were closed. I was curious, were you praying? He said, no, sir. I just hate to see women stand. Now, here was a guy, right? Here was a guy on a bus, in order to block out the problem, he just closed his eyes. And I mean, many of us do the same thing. We don't want to see it. It belongs to someone else. It's someone else's problem, not our problem. Right? It's our problem. We look for ways of bringing communities together. This is an issue where all of us need to be not just in the same book, but on the same page. So my statement to you is the following. This is our challenge for the coming year. We're all going to come together. We're all going to come together and say trafficking is something that all of us need to address collectively. It's not just female, it's a male issue. Look, let's be very candid. If men weren't trafficking, we wouldn't be here today. So, let's be in a dialogue, a trilogue, and let's be honest. And let's say we were wrong when we've been wrong all of these years and we were missing in action. So thank you for the question. Thank you, Q English, for doing this. But next year, you know, I look at you, UNICEF, US Fund. They have a mantra, I believe in zero, which means the following. I don't want to see any kids suffering in the world. They talk about all the kids who die of malnutrition, all the other forms of human suffering. And the statement is, I believe in zero. It means I don't want to see one kid lose a life for something we could have prevented. So we come here to say, not what can we do and do nothing, but the question is, what else can we do, and let's do something. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to reinforce something, if I may just take a second to say this. Sometimes, and I know you've heard this expression before, preaching to the choir. I don't believe in that, because any pastor worth his salt understands the fact that every single person in the choir can't sing. So therefore, we have to keep repeating this message until everybody gets it. Okay, the next person that I want to ask for his thoughts and his comments is a great friend of mine, and he is also one of my partners, well, not on my watch. Reverend, when I say to you, intentional men's ministry, how can we equip and empower men to address human trafficking and domestic violence issues? I know that sounds like a two-part question, but based on some of the information that we just heard, it's actually related.
Showing men how to do what's right, how to treat women. And what has happened is a lot of people have gotten away from simple teaching and men helping men become men. My son, when he was about 5 years old, he says, "Daddy, I have to go to the bathroom." He says, "Daddy, I have to go to the bathroom." So he gets up, and he walks upstairs, and about 5-10 minutes, I'm waiting for him to come back. So I sneak upstairs to see what he's doing. And he had climbed up on the sink, and he had took shaving cream, he had it all over the top of his head. He had all over the place. And so I stopped him, and I says, "What are you doing?" He says, "I'm shaving like daddy shaved." And so I sat him down on the sink, I washed his face off, and I says, "Daddy shaved because mommy likes to smooth." I said, "Feel it," and he felt it was rough. So I shaved. And then I explained to him, this is what men do. If I wasn't there, remove me out of the house, what you would have is a young man watching his mother. He'll be looking in the mirror, doing the things that his mother does. We have gotten away from the simple teaching, instructing boys how to be.
That's right.
How to teach them, how to put their hands on them, but to love them, to nurture them, to pray for them, to love on them. These are simple teaching that we as people have gotten away from. And if we can go back to that, and we, the panel, and all of us, can take our young men and keep teaching them how to do it, I believe it would work.
Thank you for that. The next question now. I talked to my much younger associate, Brother Clinton Walcott. He is much younger, but his ability to move forward, his activities define himself. So I would like to ask you now for your thoughts. Where are we as men dropping the ball insofar as male mentorship and male leadership is concerned?
Okay, see, the hardest question for last. It's always difficult to follow faith in this, because you want to get. So I try to do my best.
Yeah, we always pick on the young guys.
I want to hear you.
Can you hear me?
No, not so good.
Can you hear me now?
No. Not well.
Can you hear me now?
Better. Do something.
There's no thing. My Lord.
I think that there are many gaps.
Yeah, you gave me that one. Apologize for my voice. I've been a lot of speaking the last few days. I think that there are many gaps. I think all the rabbis and faith leaders on the panel are correct. That I think, you know, mentorship is needed and teaching, you know, young people is needed, particularly, you know, our boys. But then that's really kind of missing is that, like the Reverend just mentioned, is that, you know, men need to teach men. There needs to be the right type of men teaching the right type of lessons. And I think we got to be very careful when we talk about, you know, what's needed to raise young people and what's needed to raise, you know, boys in particular. Because you know, there's a reality and there's a truth is that a lot of our men and male figures, positive male figures, are missing from that equation. So I think that's the first part of the question. And I think that, you know, I think it's important that we realize that young people, they yield towards what's in front of them.
Right?
So if you have negative in front of them, they will yield towards negative. They have positive in front of them, they'll yield towards positive. Whoever's the most consistent example of a man in front of them, they will yield towards. So I do a lot of work with men. My entry point into working with men is around domestic violence. But the work around domestic violence is not really about what it is and, you know, the impact of it. It's really about manhood. The decisions that we make as men in terms of in our intimate relationships. And also connecting who we are as men, how we view masculinity, how we view accountability, lack of accountability, how we look at, you know, male privilege in society and our communities, recognizing that there's also racial privilege, right? I think the highest form of privilege that we have in communities is white male privilege.
And
me being a man of color, I still have male privilege in my community. Right? With that privilege comes a sense of entitlement, it comes a sense of expectation. So that's a lot of power, that's a lot of responsibility. Right? And just like you know, sex trafficking, economic sexual trafficking, all different types and domestic violence, at the core of it is about power and control and how we use it. The strategy is gaining power and control in these relationships, or maintaining power and control in these relationships, and the different tactics that are used to kind of get to that point is the different forms of abuse. So one, we have to really, in terms of the gaps, really recognizing that where we do have power, and being honest with that. Recognizing that we have all types of power, but we still have some form of power. And that we need to kind of really recognize how do we develop our notions of what it means to be a man, what it means to be a father, right? And where do we get that from? Like myself, you know, I was raised by a single mom raising two boys in New York City. Right? So you can just imagine all of those things. So a lot of my socialization came, of course, from my grandfather, my uncles, and other male figures in my family. But the primary one was my mom. And she taught us to be, you know, as a strategy, she taught us to be very masculine, hyper-masculine. And so that was really, she put us in sports, martial arts, everything that you can imagine that, you know, young boys can use, you know, if it's used correctly. And she did that because she wanted us to get home at the end of the day.
Yes.
Right? She wanted us to not only be this type of man that kind of gets the girls, which didn't happen. It was also about us navigating ourselves amongst other men. Right? So it was really about, you know, do what you need to do to survive. Gun and gang culture to survive. You know, police trying to whisper in our ear and create snitches in the communities. How to navigate. You know, just getting home and to school, to and from school. So her thing was, you and your brother get your butt home at the end of the day. That's what her major concern was.
Yeah.
So she used manhood in a particular type of way that was very hyper-masculine. And if we weren't critically conscious about why she was doing that and asking the question why, it could have went the wrong way. Right? So the other piece of it is that, you know, just in terms of this work and this panel and this conference, is that, you know, we need to realize that
sexual trafficking, domestic violence, violence against women and girls, violence against other men and boys who may not fit into this particular type of box and more vulnerable to take advantage of, is very profitable. We talked about the economic ways, but also the social, political, emotional ways where we build a false sense of value, false sense of esteem and worth. So I think it's really about being honest about what type of men are teaching our young boys and our young girls about what it means to be a man, what it means to be a father. So those are the gaps. It's important that we train that person and not just throw them in front of our kids, because we don't want them reinforcing the status quo that creates violence against women and girls.
Before I move on, I'm looking at Rabbi Vasnik's face, and I think maybe he had something that he wanted to add to that.
Yeah, I see. Q here. Q, I'm just curious about something. We had a dedication this morning, 9/11 Tribute Museum on Greenwich and Record. I hope all of you will get over there. It's an expanded museum. It's interactive. It's for all communities. And one of the co-founders, Leah Elby, said to me, "Do you know, sir, that there's no 9/11 curriculum in the public schools?" I said,
"There's no American history either in the public schools."
I find that shocking. Mm-hmm. And I thought to myself, Q, is there any curriculum in the public schools that would tell, you know, I know we talk about our responsibilities at home, but at least in the schools, is there any part of the curriculum that deals with some of these issues?
No.
You know, I just think that we are missing an opportunity if we don't reach young people at an early age and why not in school. Because one of the things we've learned over the years, education can make you smart, but not necessarily moral. Mm-hmm. If you want proof of that, engineers and lawyers, engineers built the death camps during the Holocaust. Lawyers developed the Nuremberg laws that discriminated. So they had the education, they had the degree, but they didn't have the decency. So I think there may be a way that we could work together to at least make some impact on curriculum. I'm just wondering if that's possible.
Yes, and I'm going to share what's happening now. As part of what I shared with you earlier with Not On My Watch forming the first task force under the mayor's office in combating human trafficking, we do have DOE as part of that whole piece. And what we've done recently, we are now going to be engaging, I just got confirmation, with DOE and Not On My Watch, bringing education to this public school surrounding human.
We haven't finalized all the details. We're going to be meeting throughout the summer and getting ready for that. So the answer is yes. Thank you.
All right.
At this time, I would like to ask Pastor Brown to speak on something that I know is very near and dear to him as far as the subject is concerned. How important is forgiveness as a man?
No. I do have a story, and I believe this is the first time telling my story in public. I've talked to individuals personally, not in a group setting. Many years ago, my daughter was on her way to school, and she was taken by a guy with a gun, and he took her to an abandoned building and assaulted her. And another boy was there also. She told me that the boy who had took her saw an angel, and he put the gun to her head and said he was going to shoot her, but he saw an angel and he let her go. And one of my members called me and told me that my daughter was in the hospital. And when I got there, I walked in with all the strength and power that I had. I walked in the hospital, and she fell into my arms, and I grabbed her. And if I could get a hold of that young man, so thereafter, we from the hospital, we went home, and went to the precinct, and my daughter was able to identify him through pictures, and we got his name. I've been in law enforcement for 18 years. I've been in the military, retired from the military, been in theater, combat, retired 21 years. In my unit, I've worked with correction, fire department, a number of individuals. So as the story goes, I went looking for him. I was bitter. I lost my sense. I went looking for him. I went to the house. His grandfather was there, and his grandfather didn't know where he was. And I continued to look for him, found out that he had been incarcerated on some other charges. So I found out what cell he was in, and the police department didn't know where he was. So I told them what cell he was and where he was. And so they went to arrest him, and when they found him, both arms were broken, two legs were broken, he had a concussion, and some ribs were broken. They asked me, did I know anything about it? And I told them no. And I didn't, to be honest, I didn't. So thereafter, we went to court, and we were sitting in the courtroom, and there was several court officers sitting behind me. And they asked my wife and I to say something to the judge. And my wife got up, and not to my knowledge, you know, and she said to the young man, you know, we forgive you, and I hope that you find salvation in the lockup. And she said, I forgive you. I was sitting there, and I timed myself. I said, if I could make it over these benches and get there, I wonder if the court officers could stop me. And I even put my foot like this, and I said, I believe I can get to him and choke him out. And I sat back, and I did. And when we left there, I had to take my daughter to therapy. And every day we would go to therapy, and she was sitting there. And y'all, I'm being honest, I'm a God-fearing man. I love the Lord of all my heart. But I was so bitter and angry. And have you ever seen this movie with Alfred Hitchcock? And it's a movie where is
the rope.
This lady was assaulted by a man. And she I got 1 minute. And so she they got in the car, they were driving away, and the lady says, there he is, that's him. And the guy pulls the car over, he runs over, he chokes the guy, he kills the guy. And he gets back in the car, and they're driving, and then she says, there he is! So, make a long story short, in all my bitterness, I didn't know what to do. So one day, my daughter was in the house, and she was walking by, and she came over to me, and she said, Daddy, get it together. Come on, Daddy, get it, you have to get it together. She said, what's wrong with you? And she says, listen, the boy, he hurt my flesh. But he did not hurt my spirit. I have 3 seconds left. So as I sat there, I realized that I was trying to get her to go there, and she took me there, and I was delivered, and I learned how to forgive. And if I see that young man now, you know what I would do for him? I would grab him, and I would pray for him that God would set him free. We as men, we don't forgive because we hurt. When we hurt, we want to hurt something. So that's the mindset. But today, as I sit here, guess what? I am delivered. Right. And I forgive that. All right.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, this question relates directly to youth ministry and the best, pardon me if I'm not reading this correctly. I'm not exactly sure. I'm gonna hold on this, but what I would say is that I would see Reverend Brown or any of our distinguished panelists here at the end of the session.
Thank you. And so right now, our last bit for you guys is to give us, in your opinion or in your experience, what should the real call to action be from each of you? I mean, you've given some tips along the way, but let's really talk about what is that call to action for men.
Yes.
For men, to, you know, that as you know, top of charge in perpetrating.
Call for action is for us to take responsibility for who and what we are. And not blame it on somebody else or and not to be a man about it, to be frank, to really understand that we are, as was said before, we're the cause of the problem a lot of times. To understand that we are also the place where this can be actually solved and healed. But we have to take the responsibility for it. But at the same time, we can't be afraid of it. And we're afraid of it. We're afraid to take the responsibility. We're afraid to say who we are. We're afraid to say what we desire. We're afraid to forgive, for sure. But we're also afraid to forgive ourselves. We may be able to work up a forgiveness of the other for, really, which is a horrific act, and I have to say I'm really proud of you. But to forgive ourselves, to understand what we are responsible for, and to say I'm going to move it forward, that takes some real work. And sometimes we're afraid of doing that real work. So only mouth the words. Not do the action.
Rabbi Potasnik and Quentin, why don't men hold men accountable?
Ooh. Wow. You know, I wish I had an answer that was satisfactory. There is no excuse for not holding people accountable. There is no excuse for us failing to admit that we have failed over the years. You know, how many people will assume responsibility for anything? I look at the story of Adam and Eve. It goes back to that story of creation. You know, I didn't do it. She did it. Yeah. She said, I didn't do it. The snake did it. Right? And you
no, she said she did it.
Generally, don't want to say that I'm to blame. I'm at fault. So it's pervasive in society. But Q, I just want to say the following, and I want to commend you because you've been out there. And you've inspired many of us. I measure belief by details. I measure belief by behavior. Because I remember years ago, I went to a Quaker service, and it was all silent. And I said to someone who was in a Quaker service, when does the service begin? And he said, sir, it begins when you walk outside from the sanctuary. It's what you do out there that determines how sincere you were in here. We all have windows in our house of worship. Because what we say on the inside, we got to see on the outside. So I would hope that after this kind of conference, another session we have, that we will develop initiatives where we have exchanges, where a reverend comes to a synagogue, we go to a church, and we need to see the face, I think, of those who have been trafficked. I think we can talk about it generally, but when you put a picture, a face, problem, person with problem, I think it inspires a whole different reaction. So we need to humanize this issue by talking about it. And again, we need to begin by saying we're sorry. And Reverend, I admire you. I would have forgiven the person after I had done something. I just think we're responsible, we're at fault, and we got to do a hell of a better job in addressing the problem. And again, women been out there speaking about it. Now we need the men to come forward and to really behave in a responsible fashion. That's what you expect from us.
Thank you. So we definitely need to see more, and Quentin is going to respond, more in the area of if two men are there and the one is doing wrong, and you know they're doing wrong, you know, sometimes we see the situation where it's just like a pat on the back or laughing with, you know, I guess in the area of, you know, what came out, well, I'm not going to talk about the White House thing. But anyway, basically we find ourselves as sometimes as men, or that you sort of like turn a blind eye and just sort of pat. And so I think that's the kind of difference that needs to be made in moving forward. If we can get more men to hold other men accountable, we can really turn this thing around.
Thank you, Trustee. First of all, thanks to Reverend Q for inviting me and Deborah to say that none of us touched this event.
Yeah, and you're Q number two, right?
Yeah, I'm the other Q.
I think
one of the things that we don't hold each other accountable is because we benefit from that behavior or that thinking. And, you know, so it's a certain level of honesty that we have to kind of come up with. Because it's all types of groups, right? I do a lot of work with men, or young men as well, and I speak to them individually. And they will say to me, you know, Mr. Q, yeah, this thing about violence against women and girls is terrible. Like, but when they're in a group of other men, they don't tell me the same things. Is it worried about Reverend Brown? What's he going to say about me if I step up on behalf of women? So I think it's, but, you know, so part of it is that there's a like I talked about, there's a profit to, there's profitability to keeping the status quo. It's all types of group. You know, we talk about with police, the blue wall of silence. We talk about with fraternities. We talk about with clergy. We talk about with any type of group that we're going to kind of protect our own. And there's no problem with that if we're not holding each other accountable internally. If we have somebody I can really, compare it to, because I can't hold myself accountable because I have privilege, I have certain powers, even in my organization. How can I hold myself accountable when I've done harm to an employee when they're scared of me? They won't even tell me that I'm doing wrong. So I need to be in community with someone. I got to create these safe spaces, right? So and be in practice about what accountability is. Because I can't say, after abusing you, 10 years, let's sit down at the table and you tell me what I'm doing wrong. When you're scared of me, and there's been a history of practice of me not being held accountable. So one of the things that we do with Connect is really create spaces for men. Right? We have round tables, we have workshops with fathers, with youth, and we create these spaces where we can kind of talk about what is accountability, what does that mean, how can we hold each other accountable, but with compassion. Because there's a fear that we're going to be overly harsh and male bashing and all those things, and that does not happen. Right? We're creating spaces where you can be in conversations and challenging each other respectfully, but also pushing each other to kind of look at the other side, look at the other half, other half of the sky, and kind of put ourselves in those footsteps. So over time, it's a practice. Men can hold each other accountable. It can be done in a very healthy way. And like we talked about, I think that young man you talked about, he was hurt somebody.
Hurt people.
Right, particularly youth of they're the voice of the voiceless.
Yeah.
Right. So we want to create spaces where they can talk to us and tell us and be open-ended, not tell them what you did was wrong, zero tolerance. You can't do that. We gotta get you, why did you even think that was okay? Right? We're gonna break that down and give alternatives. So like creating the spaces where we can hold each other accountable.
Thank you. And we just have one last question. If anyone can answer this. And the rest of the questions that's regarding sex trafficking, I'm going to save for the very last panel of survivors that's going to be here right after them. How can we better support, develop, trust, and educate the growing number of men in communities returning from jail, struggling with mental health illnesses, living with a history of abuse, and living with a history of exploitation, and that's sort of like following what you're talking about, Q, and shame, to reduce their victimizing? How can we help?
Let me just start with something that my friend Tasman said. One of the ways is me, as a white male, demanding that the system step up, and that they put the resources in place that will meet these challenges, and there won't be this continuous looking at making a profit off of the jail system or the prison system. Mm-hmm. White male privilege to make sure that the decision makers listen.
I just said, we have an election year coming up. It's going to be a priority item. We've got to be demanding. I know we're polite, and that's the right thing to do. Right. But we need to be polite, and you could be very demanding. I think that's the word. We spend so little on mental health. I got to commend the first lady. Priority. She has spoken in congregations of all different faith groups. We had a conference in New York. We whisper when it comes to mental health. We whisper. Cancer, we speak about it all. Mental health, I whisper in your ear. And we got to stop the whispering. We got to be more demanding, more vocal. Hugh, you've done a great job in bringing us together with elected officials. But let's do it before the election and say, this is a demand that's not going to go away. We're going to hold you accountable. And we're going to visit you the day after the election, not just the day before, to make sure you keep true to your promise.
I believe that the leaders, the clergy, need to get out to find the resource to be able to help people. If you don't have the resource or the teaching in the churches on how to help somebody, then you don't know what to do. This is the one reason why I'm here. That's a few because of what she has presented. Now, I can take what I have learned back to my church and help somebody.
Right. Yes.
And there's a lot of people that don't know what to do, how to help these people.
Can we put our hands together one more time? Please avail yourself to, if you have questions after the panel, we are going to transition. Right before we do, I also had mentioned that we're launching Not On My Watch Long Island, but we're also launching Not On My Watch Mount Vernon. And we have our Mount Vernon director here. Would you stand? Marika. And the information is out front. So please also, you can look on our website. So right before we close and transition into our next panel, which is very important, hearing the voices of the survivors directly. Some of you may not have known, but we've had a survivor and or moderator that, a panelist and or moderator that has been a survivor on every panel so that we can stay true to our word of being a survivor-led conference.
All right.
Okay, and so right now, we have Pastor Gilman Rose here. He is from the office of Borough President Eric Adams, okay, representing. And he's also over their faith-based initiatives. And I just want him to share just a few words, followed by the senator in closing, and then we're going to transition into our final panel. In the cafeteria, it's going to be our youth voices, and here is going to be survivors of adult survivors. How's that? Okay? So that's what's going to take place here right after the senator speaks, but first we'll have Pastor Gilman Rose. So let's give him a hand.
He's also the president of the 67th Precinct Council, doing incredible work here in Brooklyn.
Thank you so much, Pastor Q. I think I've been introduced the most in this conference, and you haven't seen me, right?
Yeah.
So my office is right across the street. Of course, we try to triage issues. A cat sneezes in Brooklyn when I get a call. So we want to really thank God for this opportunity. But I must say, seeing all male, white privilege, black privilege, I, for the first time, has really taken in the whole idea of human trafficking. I can't believe I've never preached a sermon in 12 years of ministry of human trafficking.
It changes today.
Yeah, no. Seriously. I have never preached a sermon on human trafficking. I know Pastor Q English have been doing this work for a long time. I don't even think that we have had a case that I can remember through Horror Hall, which a faith organization called and talked about helping someone who was in that situation. So, that is crazy. And Brooklyn is the ball of churches. So it means to say that we have
the work cut out for you.
So I am humble. I'm not an expert in this area. But one thing that I know for sure is that I'm willing to always learn and be willing to tell our shortcomings so that we can move forward. Okay. So you have my commitment moving forward that we're going to really look at. And I have some dear friends on the panel, you know, Bob Kaplan. This young man, hey, I think he has the best book. You need to be a comedian, actually. That's what God called you to be, just so you know that, right? Brother? Yeah. And like I said, Q, I've known for a long time before he had long hair, so it's good. It's good stuff. God bless everyone. Thank you so much.
And again, I'm going to ask Senator Ruth Hassel Thompson, who is now senior advisor to the governor, and she's going to share a little comments before we go into our next panel. Thank you so much for being with us today. Appreciate it. Thank you, Pastor Q. Good afternoon. I had an opportunity to speak this morning, and I'm always much more witty in the morning than I am in the afternoon. But what I tried to share with you was a little bit of the work that I had done in the Senate that led to the role that I now play for the governor as advisor on housing and community affairs for HCR. But I did, I had intended to leave shortly after lunch, but I had a deep curiosity about what the call to men was going to be like. So I stayed, sort of rearranged my afternoon schedule because it was important for me to understand the perspective on this issue from men who themselves are in leadership. But the question that I'd like to, not question, but the challenge I would like to leave with you today is that each of you will make a personal promising commitment that you will begin the dialogue wherever you have power. You talk about privilege, both white and black privilege, and certainly that exists for men in this society, and it is important that if the issue is going to be of importance, that it be addressed by people who are important. And I think you understand what that means. Because we don't want this issue to be trivialized or marginalized. And you're absolutely correct when you talk about the fact that there is so much vested that it's not in the best interest of men to address it. But I think that we are on the, we must be on the brink of change. And the only thing that I probably disagree with is that sometimes this devastation to the body does in fact impact the soul.
Yes, it does.
And it impacts the spirit. One of the things that I did not share this morning was prior to coming into elected office 25 years ago, I was a nurse and worked with a variety of patient populations, but certainly with the substance abuse population. And my job was to do counseling with women who had children under the age of 15 and to assist them in being able to keep their children. And if they did not attend my sessions or be involved with me, Child Protective would come and take the children home. And so it was very important for me not only to be able to record their attendance, but be involved with them, but give them skill sets to make them effective parents. But it was devastating for me to hear the numbers of them who had been sexually molested, who had been sex trafficked, and that, and the story that I must tell, which is the most devastating to me, was of a young woman who was 36 years old. She came, and before I did counseling, I did, I worked on the medication side and dispensed methadone. And she came to my window this particular Sunday that I was working, and she said, "Ruth, I'm having a birthday today. I'm 36 years old." And I said, "Okay. Well, happy birthday. What did you wish for yourself?" And she said, "Well, I made a wish, but I don't think it'll come true." And I said, "Okay, why bother to make the wish if you didn't think that you had the power to make it happen?" And she said, "Well, nothing in my life has ever come true for me. And so I don't know why things should be different now." And I said, "Well, tell me about the most significant birthday in your life." And she said, "The most significant birthday in my life was when I was 16 years old and my boyfriend gave me my first hit and got me hooked." And she said, "And 20 years later, here I am." So I said, "Well, let me give you a wish for you. Let me give you a wish that today will be the first day that you will change your life yourself. And that all of the things that you wish for, now you will work for." I didn't see her for many years. But I was sitting in my office in the Senate, and I got a text, and the text was from her. And she said, "I want to tell you that it has been 20 years. And she said, "I'm totally drug free." She said, "My spirit is free." And she said, "And I have you to thank for that." She said, "I thank you because you loved me when I didn't love myself. You showed me the power to begin to have self-love." And she said, "One of your women's sessions, you taught me to forgive myself." We do a lot of damage to people that we claim to love. But we can do a lot without even knowing it if we use the power that we have. So my challenge to you as men, and I will be watching. Achieve your goals. I thank you, Reverend Q. I thank you for the years of friendship, but I more thank you for listening to God's word and accepting the task that He has given you to lead us and to lead our young men and women who are in darkness to the light. Thank you again, and thank you again, everyone, for your time. I'm just hoping that you're learning something you didn't know before. Is there anybody like that in the room today? that you're getting greater understanding. Anyone now has a passion to do something about it? That's what this is really all about. And we're going to put the icing on the cake right now by inviting now our panelists for our Survivor Leadership Panel that I have amazing respect for and that have been courageous, resolute, committed to the cause, and they're going to share today and give us our marching orders as they share their stories with us. So one more time for the men, we're going to come. We ask our men, if you can stand here, we're going to take a picture right here, and we're going to get ready for the next panel.